हेलो फ्रेंड्स, प्रणाम, वेलकम वंस अगेन टू डॉक्टर राजेश वर्मा's यूट्यूब चैनल। इन दिस पर्टिकुलर वीडियो आई विल बी डिस्कसिंग विद यू द इंट्रोडक्शन टू स्टैटिस्टिक्स पार्ट टू। इन द प्रीवियस वीडियो आई टॉक्ड अबाउट द पार्ट वन। आई डिवाइडेड बाइफर्केटेड दिस मटीरियल इन टू टू वीडियोज बिकॉज इफ यू रिकॉर्ड दिस वीडियो इन दिस मटीरियल इन वन वीडियो इट विल बी लिटल बिट लॉन्ग एंड इट विल बी boring for the viewers. So for the benefits for the viewers, I have just bifurcated the total material in two videos. So this is the second part. So in the last previous video, we talked about the last content was the types of statistics. So in this part two, the first one is the branches of statistics. So statistics has two branches: a descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. So what is the descriptive one? The branch of statistics that summarize and describe certain statistical parameters such as mean, standard deviation, standard error, variance, etc. of data. So these are the various parameters. In that, when the statistical part that describes, summarize and explain these parameters, we call it that part of statistics or that branch of statistics as a descriptive statistics. And the second one, inferential statistics, the branch of statistics that used to draw conclusions and make inferences that are based on the data. So for example, when we calculate, when we apply various statistical techniques, that statistical techniques give us various results, various outcomes. So to explain that outcomes or that results, we draw some conclusions, and that part of that branch of statistics is known as the inferential statistics. In simple terms, when we explain various statistical parameters such as a mean, standard deviation, standard error and variance, that branch is a descriptive one. And when we draw some inferences or some conclusions from the data set, that is the inferential statistic. So you must understand or differentiate between the descriptive and inferential statistics. So we'll be discussing now some salient features of statistics. It's a very important one. You can also call them as a characteristics of statistics. Through analysis, statistics provide meaning to the measurement. So this is a very important one. You measure something, the measurement remains measurement till we apply the statistical techniques to that. You measure your height of your classroom students. So you have various students, almost 100 students or 80 students, and the height is different height. They have different height. So what that mean? What this measurement means? Till that time, you calculate the mean, you calculate the standard deviation, standard error, median or some various other statistical parameters, that time that statistical techniques give meaning to the measurement. You say the statistical techniques are the cosmetics, are the adjectives of the data of the measurement, because without adjectives, without the cosmetics, the face is dull, have no meaning. So similarly, this is very important. The statistical techniques provide meanings to the measurement. The second salient feature is the statistics also explore or establishes relationship between data and its application. We have some data, and when we apply that data to the required field, so what is the relationship between data and its application? Who describes that? Who explains that? Certainly someone has to be there. And do not worry about that, statistics is there to help that. So it's a very important salient feature that it describes the relationship between the data and its application. Then the next one, it helps in precising and making accurate descriptions of the data. When we take the data, we have to describe the data, we have to make precise outcomes. To help that, we use statistics. It's a very important tool and technique. So you must know that. Next, the statistics is a logical process. There is no trial and error are in the statistics. It's a logical process which provide a way of thinking, vocabulary and language. There is no randomness in statistics. Though there is a, we use randomness when selecting the data or selecting the sample, or when we dividing the sample into two various groups, that time we use the randomness. But as far as the statistical techniques is concerned, it's a purely algorithm. Step by step, we calculate that. There is no illogical things, because statistics is a logical process, scientific process, and it's a very technical process. So by virtue of its various qualities, it provides, it's a way of thinking, vocabulary and language. It's a very important one. Then the next, statistics makes data talk. It's a very funny thing. Yes, there's a data is a data. It doesn't convey anything, whether it is a grouped one or ungrouped one. But the moment you apply the statistical techniques to data, the data starts saying something. It means that the conclusions, the inferences that we derive from the data, that says something. And that means to say that statistics makes the data talk. It's a very important one. Statistics deals with both type of data, that is enumeration data and metric data. Okay, next. Now, these were the six very salient features, important characteristics of statistics. Now, what are the uses of statistics in psychology? Now, let us understand the statistics from the perspective of psychology. What are the uses in that? The statistics employed to achieve the following uses. The first one, analyzing the causal factors behind a phenomena. Why that phenomena occurs? What are the factors that cause this phenomena? Who explains that? No one except statistics and statistical techniques. Second, summarizing or describing large amount of data. Suppose you have a data of 10,000 people. What inferences can you make from the 10,000 people data? It will be a little bit harder for you to manage the data, summarize the data, to calculate even a mean of that so large data. It's a bit difficult for you. And what is that that helps you? Who helps in summarizing, describing that data? Your statistics. So statistics is a right, left, both the hands of a researcher. Getting my point? It's neither left or right, it's both the hands of the experimenter who conducts various experiments in the laboratory or in the field. Next, making comparison between individual and groups or groups. So you want to compare two groups, more than two groups. You want to compare two or more than two individuals. Who will help them? First, to collect data. Then you have the data. Then who will help them to compare that data? Certainly it is the statistics. You cannot escape away. If you are a psychology researcher, psychology student, you cannot escape from statistics. Because statistics is a very vital tool which is used in psychology to predict human behavior, to conduct various experiments in the laboratory or in the field. So it's a very important one. Next use of statistics is to explore or establish the relationship between measured variables. We use or we wager various variables, psychological variables. So to understand, to know, to explore, to establish a relationship between these measured variables, who comes handy? Certainly it's statistics. So you must know statistics if you are a psychology student. Then making predictions about the future events. Can you tell how an individual will behave in the future in certain conditions or certain situations, or that individual is provided with a certain type of stimulus, how she or she will behave? How you can predict? Who will help you in that prediction? Of course, it is statistics. So if you are a psychology researcher or a student, if you want to predict something, certainly you must know the statistics. It's a very handy tool for a researcher. Then the sixth use of statistics, it aids in informed decision making. If you are in a particular situation and if you have to make a decision about the particular situation, who will help you? People will decide, suggest you various ideas. But if you want to go for the informed decision, and the decision that provides you the maximum benefit, then statistics is a very handy tool. It's a very important one. So you must know the statistics. These are the various uses of statistics in psychology. Now, one important point. Attention, my dear friends. Pay your attention here. Focus your attention here. The statistics can be used or misused because it makes the data talk. It depends upon you, upon the researcher, how and what data should say. That means statistics can be used or misused. To prevent the misuse of statistics, we must adhere to the following points. That is, the inferences arrived at by statistics need careful interpretation. You have to interpret that inferences, conclusions very, very carefully, with both the eyes open, with a great thought process and carefully, because incorrect interpretations are worse than wasted efforts. If you make an incorrect interpretation of a particular data, that can create a big havoc in the minds of the individual. Suppose you are measuring the intelligence or IQ. While doing some applying some statistical technique, there is an error occurred, and the calculated IQ comes to be 70. In that case, your statistics will tell that IQ is 70. Will you able to tell at that moment to a subject that your IQ is 70? Is it less than average? What will happen to that individual? He or she starts feeling, oh, I am so feeble minded. My IQ is so. This means I cannot do anything. I cannot study more. And you do not know how badly that your decision, your conclusion will impact that individual. It has ruined various lives. So my dear friends, students and viewers, be very, very careful, double check before arriving at the decisions based on the inferences or the conclusions drawn from the statistics. The second point that needs to your attention. Before application of statistical techniques, the researcher must make sure that the data meets the assumptions of intending statistical technique. This is a very important one. People collect data, and after that data, they say, I want to apply that particular technique. Is it feasible? Is it possible? And they focus on the assumptions of. These are things I have seen in various students. They come to me, sir, I want to use factor analysis. I want to use the multiple regression. They do not know the assumptions of multiple regression. They do not know what are the basic assumptions of factor analysis. Till that time, you do not know these techniques or these assumptions, how you can apply that. So before applying these statistical techniques, the student, the researcher, experimenter must know the specific assumptions of that statistical technique. Then only you are required to use that statistical technique. So dear friends, the third thing that require your kind attention, focused attention, is the refrain from making general remarks based on statistical references. This is a big tendency among the researchers. They want to gain something big, fame and name. What they do is they come out with little bit of specific inferences, and based on the specific inferences that has been drawn with the data, and the data is collected on the some particular sample, out of that they want to generalize that results. It's a big mistake. Kindly do not come to that point that you just start using that particular inferences or conclusions for the general population. So these are the three points that need your attention. Then comes the, my dear friends, what are the description of various terms used in the statistics. First, I'll be talking about the enumeration of the data. The data that yields frequencies as a result of counting is known as the enumeration data. Then comes the metric data or the measurement. The data that has been obtained as a result of measurements is known as the metric data or the measurements. the data that has been obtained as a result of measurement, that you have measured something and you quantified the data. So that is known as the metric data. Then comes the mean, median and mode. A single number, all are the measures of central tendency. So they are the single number and that provide scientific description about the position of an individual, group, sample or a product or a continuum in a context of others. So this is very important. These are the mean, median, mode. What are that? They are the single number that provide the scientific description about the position of an individual, group, sample or a product or a continuum in context of others. Then the standard deviation, SD, statistical indicator of an amount of variability in a set of individuals or observations or data set. SD is an index, statistical index, that provide the amount of variability present in the set of individuals, observations or a data set. So it's a variability index. These are terms you will be frequently using in your statistical technique. Then comes the coefficient of correlation. What is coefficient correlation? The degree and direction. The direction either can be positive or the negative. Of closeness of relationship between two sets of measures of the same group of individuals or observations. Suppose you collect two set of observations from same group or different group, and you want to see the correlation between that. What is the degree of the correlation and what is the direction of that correlation? So to measure that, you will come out with a way, you are using various Carl Pearson methods and various correlation techniques. With that, you will come with an index, and that index is a kind of coefficient. That coefficient will tell you the degree of closeness between the two set of observations or the individuals or the groups. That the degree is high, low, middle or nil, or complete or the perfect correlation. And that is also known as the coefficient of correlation. It can be positive between the two measures or negative. Positive means if there is an increase in the value of particular measure, one of observation, then certainly in the other observation also there will be increase. But if there is a decrease in one, there will be decrease in other ones. This is a positive correlation. Where is the negative one? If there is increase in one measurements, certainly there will be decrease in the other measurements. That is known as the negative correlation and vice versa. Then the sample. What is sample? A group of people, individuals, representing the population of interest selected for an experiment. If you want to go for an experiment, you cannot perform your experiment on the whole population. What to do that? How to overcome that? That problem you have to do, you have to select some particular sample, particular people, randomly you will select that, and that sample must be representative of the population of the interest or the population you want to study. For example, you want to study the some motivational level or aptitude, attitude or something else. You want to measure the intelligence of entire adolescents of India. Is it possible for you to measure the intelligence or IQ score of the entire adolescents? It's almost equal to impossible. So for that, what you have to do? You have to collect particular sample. That sample must be representative. That you have to adhere to the various random techniques and all everything that while sampling. So sample is a group of people representing the population of interest selected for the experiment. And my dear friends, next one is the sampling statistics. It tells the degree of representativeness of the population from the sample has been drawn. So how much that sample represents the population of the interest or the population from which the sample has been drawn, that is known as the sampling statistics. Then comes the standard error. It's an index, again, it's an index number that leads us to conclusion concerning how far the statistic derived from sample probability differs from the value we would obtain if we had measured the entire population. I'll tell you in simple words. I told you if you measure the IQ, if there is an experiment for you to measure the IQ of all adolescents of India, it is not feasible for you. What you do is you draw a sample from a sample of adolescents. You measure their IQ. Now there is an error because you have not measured the whole population, but you have measured only one sample. Certainly, there will be a difference between the if we measure the whole population, measure the IQ of the whole population and the IQ of that sample. So that difference is known as the standard error. That difference will certainly will come, because there if the population is in crores and you are measuring the IQ of a few hundred people, so there will certainly will be there will be difference. So that difference will be known as the standard error. And next is the population, a well-defined group of people or observation that we intending to measure, or the population that in which we have interest, or for that we have to calculate our particular complete our experiment. So that is the population. Suppose I we are just in the previous example we talked about the adolescents. Adolescents is purely a population. Getting my point? So these were the certain terms, my dear friends, and there was a second part of introductory part of the statistics. We have discussed the branches, we have discussed the various other factors, various sampling terms use of psychology, use of statistics psychology, my dear friends. So if you have any doubt, if you want to say something, just write my comment box, or you can email me at varmasujit@yahoo.com. Dear friends, next discussion will be frequency distribution. That is also one of the important statistical technique. So if you love this video, like this video, share with others. If you have some, if you want to say something to me, if you don't like it or you dislike, kindly share with me through writing my comment box or writing to me through my email. My email is varmasujit@yahoo.com. Thank you, my dear friends, watching this video.